Hello, I'm Ron. I work at ING Bank at the rather interesting intersection of technology, strategy, and innovation. Thank you so much for signing up to the session. For the next 20 minutes or so, I will share an approach to innovation that's less top-down, more calm, and maybe not so much organized, while still delivering true impact. Now, this approach is very dear to my heart, and I'm looking forward to your feedback and comments. So over the course of this video, I will be watching the chat. So please share your questions and let me learn from you. But for now, sit back, relax, and enjoy the ride. And here we are, in very different circumstances than any of us may have imagined only half a year ago. We did not get to meet each other in a conference venue in one of Europe's amazing cities. We did not bump into each other this morning while queuing for coffee. We will not get to exchange ideas later on over a few networking drinks. And still, here we are. I managed to record a video last week in my attic turned studio. And you are now watching that video in your home office or in your garden or maybe in your favorite local coffee shop, hoping that the Wi-Fi stays on. And that right there is truly fascinating. Would we have been able to meet like this 5 years ago? Or 10 years ago? For sure not 20 years ago. And that's worth reflecting on for a bit. We are living in truly unique times. Yes, there's the pandemic, obviously. But there is also the ongoing paradigm shift of digitization. Digitization of product features. Digitization of service discovery and service delivery. Digitization of communication, really. And digitization has unlocked some truly transformative changes. First and foremost, the complexity, the effort, and ultimately cost involved in creating digitally is low and getting lower. Take this video as an example. In creating it, I used a few simple tools that are either very cheap or for free even. In fact, the most expensive tool used in the creation of this video was the physical microphone. And likewise, distributing bits and bytes is cheap and simple. Taking this video as an example once more, distributing it was as simple as dropping a file in a shared folder. And all you needed to join this session was a modern and free web browser. And not only is distribution cheap, reach is almost infinite. With a digital product or a digital service, you can potentially reach 5 billion people on this planet connected to the internet. Now, zero cost and nearly infinite leverage, that has a profound impact on the institutions we are familiar with. The firm, the customer, and indeed, innovation. And let's delve a bit deeper into the increasingly important role of users in innovation. There are different modes to innovating. And these modes differ in the level of control the organization has over the innovation process and its outcomes. So for one, there was the expert mode of innovation. And in this mode, the organization not only understands the problem very well, it fully owns the solution to that problem. A nice example would be developing a mobile app. Every button, every text, every splash of color, every animation has been put in there by the organization's designers and developers. Its users may figure in clinics and will provide feedback and ratings later on, but they did not have an active hand in creating the solution. Now, there is a mode of innovation in which users are involved in creating the outcome. IKEA is a great example. I think that many of us will have spent a lovely Saturday afternoons assembling a flat pack into a piece of furniture. Great fun that is. Now, to be really honest here, I would be happy in assembling a cupboard more or less stable without too many screws being left over. But here was a restaurant in Amsterdam, and its interior decorator took precisely this cupboard, left some elements out, painted it in a striking color, turned it over, stuck it to the ceiling, and turned it into a lamp. Now, not only is this quite creative, but I'm pretty sure that it surpasses what even the cupboard's original designer thought to be possible when designing that cupboard. And there is a site called IkeaHackers.net that is chock full of applications like these, the things people do to a Billy. And this website is not affiliated to IKEA, and none of its contributors are IKEA's employees. And this website serves as a great example of a mode of innovating that's quite apparent in platforms specifically. That's a mode in which users are not only involved in creating the innovation's outcome, they're dominating it. Let's take Airbnb as an example here. There are more than 2,000 tree houses on Airbnb. But the tree house as a product category is not of Airbnb's doing. It's the very first user that brought his or her treehouse to the platform that validated the viability and feasibility of this product category. And it's the other users of Airbnb that actually signed up to be a guest at this treehouse that validated the desirability of treehouses as a product category. Nothing to do with product or marketing at Airbnb. And an example of not a new product category, but a whole new adjacent product segment, is the Sake Tour in Tokyo. It's organized by a sake sommelier and takes a small group of people along a few sake distilleries in Tokyo. There is no airbed involved, there is no apartment to let, there is no house, not even a treehouse, just a tour. And here too, this was not devised by Airbnb, but by the very first sake sommelier that put the tour up for booking on the site. And with people actually signing up for that tour and enjoying it thoroughly. So here we have a whole new business for Airbnb that ultimately sprung from the mind of a single individual user. And here's AirDNA. AirDNA scrapes data from Airbnb's websites worldwide. And from this data, it provides detailed analysis on pricing, occupancy, seasonality, and revenue. And as a property investor, or a future host, or a city representative, you take a subscription to AirDNA to get these detailed insights into the market of your interest. And these insights apparently go way beyond to what Airbnb is offering. So AirDNA has uncovered a complementary business model to Airbnb's. So there is this spectrum from innovation of a service by expert to innovation for service by users. Or to make that a bit stronger, for innovation of a service to innovation for others, the users to innovate. That first mode of experts innovating a product or service is well understood. It comes with practices we all know, like service design, design thinking, lean startup, UX and CX. These are standard parts of the expert innovator's toolbox. That second mode of users innovating on an organization's behalf seems less developed and less understood. It for sure wasn't part of my toolbox. So let's delve a bit deeper and understand what it takes to thrive with this mode of innovating. Now you may think I'm pointing to this anarchy where everyone gets to do as she or he pleases. That's not the case, really isn't. What I would like to point out is that there are different forms of organizing for innovation. So the expert way of organizing is to rally researchers and designers and envision and define your next innovation. When that's moving along nicely, you engage product and software developers and start creating the MVP of your product and service. And that MVP will be passed on to its intended users to hopefully critical success. So this indeed is experts pushing an innovation at increasing levels of maturity through the organization and the market. Another way of organizing, though, is to, as an expert, not create the finished products or services yourself. Instead, you deliver the tools and the building blocks for creating such products and services. So coming back to Airbnb, for many of its users, Airbnb is a tool. Another example is iOS and its rich toolset and building blocks for creating mobile applications. Put that toolset in the hand of its users, developers, and they will build things. And sometimes that's the obvious, like a mail app or any productivity app. Sometimes it's the seemingly trivial, like a flashlight app. And sometimes it's downright ridiculous, like a $1,000 VIP concierge app. And over time, these initial users set a standard of what works and what works not. And this standard inspires a whole new generation of users to come and create higher order products and services. Some of these users will create additional tools on top of your tools. An example of this is TestFlight. That's an online service for testing mobile applications. It was developed by a third party, not Apple, and in the end got so successful and so valuable to the overall community that it got acquired by Apple. Again, this is a great example of users innovating on behalf of and to the benefit of the parent organization. Other users will integrate their service offerings with yours. Google Maps and Fitbit are great examples. Fitbit brought wearable functionality to iOS users long before Apple did with the Apple Watch. And till this day, Google Maps is arguably a better offering than Apple's own mapping effort. And these higher order value creations just spiral on and on and on. Take Uber as an example. It's built on top of iOS and Google Maps. So what we are dealing with here is users adopting your expert tools and components, as well as the work of other users. And the structure is much more bottom-up network than top-down hierarchy. Allow me to wind down this session with an example I've actually been involved with. So for the past few years, together with my colleague Adriana, I've been trying to capture the impact of the platform economy, not only on our organization, but on our communities and society at large as well. Now, platform and platform design and platform thinking is a very extensive and complex topic, and probably worth a virtual session all by itself. So for now, I'm gonna focus on how we used the tool-based approach in driving adoption of platform thinking, platform design, and platform strategy. When building our tools, we took inspiration from board games. For instance, a game like Catan that you may be familiar with. And the reason for that is that these games specifically hide a lot of complexity behind a few simple rules, and because they make collaboration a fun thing to do. So we built a board game. A board game for individuals, teams, organizations, develop actionable understanding of their purpose and place in a platform context. And like any game, our game comes with a manual, playing cards, and some examples. We even packaged our tool like a game, and it comes in a nice box that contains all the materials one would need to start off a round of platform design and platform strategy. No consultants, no coaches are needed to play such a round. We also added support in the shape of a Slack channel and a Trello board for our users to get inspired and to share their insights. So, how successful have we been in the adoption of this tool? Have we seen people building on top of it? Well, here was a group of people that included Playmobil into the game to add some detail and more liveliness to be able to better discuss bottlenecks and opportunities. Well, that's for sure something we didn't plan on, but it's nice to see that the modular nature of the game apparently invites for such an initiative. And we're going to work explicitly to turn the inclusion of Playmobil as a practice for all. We have also seen adoption of the tool outside our organization. Here is an example of a startup that is building out a multi-sided marketplace for waste disposal and waste management. And they have been pioneering the use of color explicitly to highlight the various sites in the marketplace. And as such, they're using the tool much more strategically than we originally intended. And as an extension to this, we are now aware of a freelance strategy consultant, this gentleman to be exact, building an ecosystem strategy service offering on top of the tools. An ecosystem strategy is a different application, is a different positioning than we initially set out for. So, there we are. Three different applications of the tool that have been taking the tool into directions and context we didn't envision for. And each of these initiatives individually, but certainly taken together, improve the tool, improve the application of the tool for all of its users. And to keep improving the tool, and to keep improving faster, perhaps, we have open source the full tool set. So it's available to each and anyone. So it's available to you all. And here are some links where you can find information on the tool and how to download it. You can also see my email address and my presence on LinkedIn. I'd love to learn from your observations, your remark, your feedback. So please do get in touch if you have questions or would like to have a discussion on the topic. My virtual door is always open. If everything went to plan, then we also should have some minutes for Q&A in this session, and I'm happy to take your questions and learn from those. But in any case, thank you for attending. Much appreciated.